taught at BYU. He's taught at the University of Utah as a filmmaker. And perhaps most importantly, he is responsible for producing and directing the Mormon Temple Ceremony films. And he's just been a legend within Mormonism as a filmmaker for so many years. And he's also produced films for the Mormon subsidiary, the LDS Church's subsidiary, that produced as recently as last year a Mormon film about Jane Manning James and Joseph Smith. But the point is, he abused Sean when Sean was a young boy, sexually abused him, and the church knew about it, and the church covered it up and neglected to give Sean any resources or support. And he wasn't excommunicated, the Sterling Van Wagenen person, and he went on to serve as a gospel doctrine teacher, as a state high counselor, and again, he ended up both teaching at BYU and the University of Utah, and eventually was asked to help co-produce these Mormon movies. And the fact that the church did not excommunicate him, that they allowed him to remain a member in good standing and then gave him continued positions of influence and support, allowed Sterling Van Wagenen to sexually abuse other victims. And we're going to get into that. And we're going to get into, again, not as a reason to pile on Sterling Van Wagenen, who now is about to go to prison. But the bigger problem we have is with the system, the systematic cover-up of sexual abuse. We've covered it with the Chris Swallow interview that I did on Mormon Stories podcast, where he experienced abuse at the hands of Lowell Robison, who is no longer with us. And we also have covered it with McKenna Denson and Joseph Bishop, and we've talked about how the church covered up Joseph Bishop's abuse and continued to give him callings and didn't punish him, and how McKenna Denson suffered as a result. We've talked about Sam Young, who simply just tried to call attention to the abuse that's been perpetrated, and he was excommunicated immediately for calling the church to accountability for its protection of abusers at the expense of the abused. And it's just mind-boggling. And this is going to be yet another testimony of how the church has cared more about its reputation and its legal risks and whatever financial concerns might come about as a result of broad awareness of these abuses and how victims suffer as a result. And so that's just a setup for Sean's story. And even though you've already heard his whole faith journey, it's now time to kind of focus like lasers on this story, Sean. So let's go back. Sean and Crystal, welcome back to Mormon Stories.
Thank you.
Thank you
for joining us. And if it's okay, let's go back, Sean, and tell us, you know, whatever you want to about the events leading up to that awful night of abuse that you experienced.
Sure. I was best friends with two of Sterling Van Wagenen's youngest sons. We lived about three doors down, and that's how we got to know them. And we did everything together. All day, every day, we played together. And these were like my little brothers. I didn't have little brothers or little sisters, but these were my little brothers. We were really close. And I was sleeping over at their house.